So I just wanted to say just a few words about the session today and how we're going to be going along. First of all, it's just a delight to see you all here, and I'll move away from this other microphone so I don't screw things up. It's a delight to see you all here today, and many of you know our sort of history of having summits of this nature, looking at various issues in science communications and to practice with you. And it's part of our commitment to help build a community of practice around best practices in science communications in our research partners at the labs, at the universities, our user facilities, and other research business partners across the United States and globally, for that matter. It's really critical, I think, in at this point, and especially yesterday, having seen the release of the budget, as you know, in our annual frenzy of graphs and tables that we're going to add to today, because I know you're all interested in these, in what it is we're actually communicating about. We're delighted to have some folks here who can speak to that with great authority. But it's up to us then to tell people what those dollars mean and what those dollars translate into. And increasingly, a lot of those dollars translate into work that is done at our universities, work done in conjunction with our laboratories at our universities, work done at our user facilities by university PIs. There are a lot of places where this intersection is really critical for us. A number of universities are in fact managing partners of some of our national laboratories. So in conjunction with a number of folks who are in the room today and who I'll call out in just a moment, we created this program to help reflect on how we make these connections between our community of practice and the Department of Energy and other federal agency and the university research community and the university communications community. I mentioned we had a really excellent planning committee to help us put this together. So I want to give all the credit to them. And then when you have problems or anything, just tell them it sucked and it's your fault. You know, you're going to tell them they had great ideas, and if there was any fault in the execution, that fault is ours. So if I could have you stand up, please. Terry Devitt from the University of Wisconsin. Terry, where are you? There you are. Pete Genzer, Brookhaven. David Goddard, Tennessee. David Kime, Oak Ridge National Laboratory. Karen King, Michigan State University, the Facility for Rare Isotope Beams. There you are. Tom Rickey, Pacific Northwest. So you come in. And Catherine Zandanella from Princeton University. I'd like you guys to give them a round of applause. So we also benefited enormously, and we continue to benefit enormously from the support of the Office of Science Senior Leadership here today. And you'll hear a little bit more about who we have representing that senior leadership here from my boss and the director, the Associate Director for Resource Management in the Office of Science, Jeff Salmon. Jeff has been a consistent supporter of our communications efforts. In fact, convened the first of these summits in 2012, which, as many of the folks here from the laboratories know, led to the creation of the National Laboratory Chief Communication Officers Group as a formal mechanism for communicating among the laboratories. We held another summit in 2014, which gave us our strategic plan, and we continue to think that this is a summit that will give us equally useful and good guidance and blueprints going forward. With that, I'd like to introduce Jeff, who will introduce our boss.
So welcome, and thank you all for coming. This is, in fact, the third summit we've held, the communication summit we've held here. And as it turns out, every year we do a little more, and each summit gets a little better. So I think this is this particular forum is particularly exciting because it's looking at something we've been working on for years, that is to tell the story of DOE support for the broad community. I've had the experience of talking about the Office of Science Research and DOE research in general, and many times the audience, somebody from the audience will say, well, but you're just a closed shop. Your DOE Office of Science is primarily interested in funding the lab, and whereas we have this very large responsibility towards the laboratory community, this is not a closed shop, and I think the message we'll get today and some of the discussions will show us how to communicate that fact to a broader community. I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Cherry Murray at Lawrence Livermore Lab some years ago on a whirlwind tour with Ray Orbach. What I remember most about that was the fact that Dr. Orbach showed up 3 hours early for the tour, but Dr. Murray was ready and able. So,
that was 2004.
Yeah, it was long. He was director at that point. But he had the tendency to show up early, so we had to be slightly fleet of foot. It's a great pleasure for me to get. This is the first opportunity I've had to introduce my new boss. Dr. Murray is a member of the National Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Engineering, and the National Academy of Arts and Science, which I always read that. I think those are the people that do the Oscars, but it's different. Prior to being nominated for Director of the Office of Science by President Obama and confirmed by the Senate, Dr. Murray was Benjamin Pierce Professor of Technology and Public Policy and Professor of Physics at Harvard. We are delighted that she is with us as our new leader of the Office of Science. And so, without further ado, let me introduce Dr. Murray.
So the way that Rick has organized this program is I am going to introduce Kei Koizumi. He's going to talk, and then I'm going to talk. So I have known Kei for probably 20 years, 25 years, something like that. He is now the Assistant Director of Federal Research and Development at OSTP. Before that, for many, many years, he was at AAAS, and when I was on the AAAS board, we interacted quite regularly. When John Holdren became Director of OSTP and the President's Science Advisor, he stole Kei from AAAS. And without further ado, I'm looking forward to what he has to say.
All right, good morning, everyone. Great to see you here at DOE Forest Hill Building. So today, before really the meat of the discussions that you are having today, I wanted to say a few words about why we are all here today. Why it's important that we're all here today. So today we're here to talk about why research is important and why communicating about research is important. Now the importance of science and engineering research is acknowledged and understood by a lot of people, especially in Washington D.C. So President Obama understands it. The Obama administration understands it. But we know that not everyone understands the importance of what the federal government does in supporting research around the country. Therefore, it's important for all of us to try to communicate about the important work that's going on, supported by Office of Science, in the labs, in companies, and in universities around the country. So, first, a little bit about what I do. So at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, as Dr. Murray said, I have the pleasure of working for President Obama's science advisor, John Holdren. He's also the director of the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. So what we try to do at OSTP is, on behalf of the president, we try to link scientific research to the challenges that we face as a nation. And to make sure that government policies that are not science policies, including budget policies, support the science that we need to answer the questions and provide us the options we need to tackle these challenges. So to do that, there are a set of policies in the federal government that are more or less purely science policy about how the scientific enterprise works. How universities can conduct research, etc. But there are all sorts of other policy areas in which it's not about the science explicitly, but it's about how we use science to make better decisions and to, you know, make some progress on the things that we've always faced as a nation. So we try to make sure that the new knowledge and new technologies that come out of the government support of research at your institutions feeds back into the policy process so that policy is informed by the best available science and technology. Climate science is one example. Science, the best knowledge that we have about how our planet is changing is a solid foundation for the President's Climate Action Plan, which is a set of policies to try to combat climate change, to mitigate it and adapt to it. So science is a foundation of many things that the federal government does. But we need you, and we need all of us, myself included, to communicate about the importance of federal support to research. And we, from you, we need help in making the abstract concrete. Because what I'm about to show you can be rather abstract. It's about dollars, it's about policies, it's about priorities. What you can provide is the people, the discoveries, the cool things that you guys get to operate in your institution. Because, you know, I can tell you, and I think I will, about how important federal support of research is to sustaining U.S. excellence in basic research that underpins so much of our economic competitiveness. Or I can tell you how federal investment in clean energy, R&D, and in DOE and other agencies have led to a technological revolution in solar and wind energy. Actually, I don't have to tell you, because if you walk around, you'll see posters telling you in DOE. But I can't make that concrete for people, communities, and universities around the nation. Only you can, and when we work together. So I live in the world of data about research and development funding, as Dr. Murray remembers. And I can show you the data, so I will. I'll show you my data. The federal government supports a lot of research, the R in R&D.
And because we knew that you'd be squinting our eyes to see this, you can follow along with Kay's presentation in your packet.
That's wonderful. Thank you. So this is the R in R&D. There's even more D, that's the development, that's not shown on the slide. So the federal government invests $70 billion a year in research. And you can see in bright green where the Department of Energy fits in, including lots of science. Fully half of this research is performed at the nation's colleges and universities, something that many people don't know. And of the remainder, a great portion of it is performed in our national labs. So you are here. Your institutions are here in what I'm showing you. I also live in the world of data about DOE's Office of Science. You know, I know that the Office of Science is the largest federal supporter of research in the physical sciences, and that it's an important supporter of research in most of the other science and engineering disciplines, including the life sciences, environmental sciences, computer science, engineering, mathematics, and basic energy sciences. And I know that the Office of Science is the largest federal supporter of the one-of-a-kind scientific user facilities that the entire U.S. science and engineering research enterprise depends on to do its exciting research. I know this, you know this, but what do these data mean in the world? Does everyone else know this? What you can provide are the stories, the details, the people supported by this federal research investment at your institution. You can translate the dollars here into real science and real people. You can make it real by describing what a physical sciences research project is, or what kind of questions DOE-funded scientists are trying to answer when they turn on a neutrino beam, or how many students from your local communities are involved in doing research on a tokamak, or just why it takes an enormous ring-shaped machine to move tiny, tiny subatomic particles around. You can introduce us all to the real people, students, and scientists and others who are doing fascinating work. at the cutting edge of science and who are trying to find answers to some exciting questions. I know that in many ways you have it easy because there are so many exciting projects going on. You know, I've been fortunate enough to visit several of the DOE national laboratories. For example, I've been to Fermilab and I've had the excitement of, you know, standing, I guess, in a neutron beam deep underground and knowing that neutrinos are going through me and that they're coming out the other end 1,000 miles away in Minnesota where they are detected. I've been to Argonne, I've been to Oak Ridge National Laboratory where I had the pleasure of seeing this brand new computing facility and meeting some of the people who run it. So I know there's amazing work going on there, but of course some of the stories I was told are a little bit missing because I don't know who is actually doing research on that computing facility in Oak Ridge. I don't know what kind of questions that are being asked with that computing facility, or what kind of answers are coming out of that. So there is amazing work going on there, and I appreciate the PIOs and communications officers from the labs who help tell the story, not just to me, but to visitors and especially to students and others from the community surrounding the labs. I've also been fortunate enough to visit several of the universities supported by Office of Science Research, Ohio State, my hometown university, not here today, doing excellent work in computing and in basic energy. Michigan State, you are here, where I had the pleasure of seeing the facility of rare isotope beams under construction. It's coming along well. I'm very excited. I want to be around soon for the opening of that. There was a special pleasure I will share because coming from Ohio, actually that was the first time I crossed that border into Michigan. So I didn't want to go to Ann Arbor, so I went to East Lansing. So GW, George Washington University, right here at DC, my alma mater, where there's a brand new science and engineering hall doing great work on a variety of energy-related topics. So we are counting on all of you to tell these stories and to find better ways to spread the news far and wide. So in that spirit, I'm going to tell a little of my story now, the story of the President's 2017 budget released yesterday. It's a great budget for science, for the Office of Science. I'd like to share with you now how, you know, my vision for how the research you are supporting and telling the stories about fit into what the President and the administration are trying to accomplish in the coming year. So when the federal government, as I said, supports a lot of research, you know, $70 billion a year of research, $150 billion a year if you count the development funding. And we do that because we've long done this pretty much ever since the end of World War II, and in World War II, we've supported research and development as a federal government because of the many benefits that support provides in terms of expanding our knowledge about the universe, providing us with new technologies for the civilian marketplace, and also for making progress on a number of the government's missions, and that includes, accelerating the pace of innovation to create jobs. That includes improving Americans' health, moving toward a cleaner, a more energy-efficient energy system, taking action on climate change, and preparing our students with skills in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So for President Obama, this is why the federal government is investing as much as it does in research. And so the challenge for all of us is to, you know, sustain that support. So these are some of the numbers, and also to make sure that people understand that behind these numbers that are generated in Washington, in my office building, that behind all of these dollars are real people, real scientists and engineering, and engineers doing great work. So here are some of those numbers, and here are some of the things that we are focusing on. So I want to show a little bit about one example. One priority for the President is to take action on climate change that is affecting not only the United States, of course, but the entire world. And to do that, the administration has put forward a number of policies in areas of transportation and energy use, and also of and power generation. To do that, we first have to understand what is going on, what is actually happening to the planet, and what are our options for dealing with the changes that we've already committed to. So Department of Energy is an important contributor to that research and development effort. So last week, President Obama announced that as part of what we are calling Mission Innovation, the U.S. government is participating with 19 other nations to double the government's investments in clean energy research and development. So in the 2017 budget that the president released yesterday, the proposal is to be on a path to doubling that federal government investment in energy R&D between 2016 this year and 2021, 5 years from now. So the 2017 budget, you can do the math. If you're going to double in 5 years, it's going to take about a 15 to 20% increase each year. That $7.7 billion that's proposed in this budget will put us on that trajectory. And as Dr. Murray will describe, the Office of Science is a key part of the mission innovation effort because the basic energy research that's supported by Office of Science is an important part of the government's commitment to supporting clean energy research. And these research initiatives are done in conjunction with several other units here in the Department of Energy and the Department of Transportation and NASA. So those are some of the reasons that the federal government is supporting research and why the budget that the president released yesterday is so positive toward science and technology. So that is actually my the condensed version of my budget talk, because I'm going to spend the rest of my time talking about the nation's capital, where you are right now. Here we are in Washington, D.C., so I think you have the physical reality of things are a little bit different here than where you may work in petrol labs and universities. So, welcome to Washington. Why do we need to communicate about university and national lab research? I've given a few reasons why. Let me say a few words about why it's important in this context of where we are in the nation's capital. So, we need to work together to communicate, number one, as I said, because it's the right thing to do. We have exciting work going on in our institutions, and we should want to talk about it. But number two, as I think I've said, the federal government, that is all of us as taxpayers, invests a lot of money in research and development. They and we ought to know what we're supporting and why it's so important and exciting, because that support is never guaranteed. Over the longer term, the American people will only trust us to invest these funds wisely if they understand what they are investing. As an aside, that means, I really hope, you take the time to credit the Office of Science with supporting the work that goes on in your labs, because I want to know, if an exciting scientific discovery is announced in a journal, one of the first things I look for at the back is, which federal agency that I work with supported that work. So please make that clear, because the Office of Science wants the credit. Of course, your institutions want the credit. We all want the credit for having supported this exciting work. Okay, in this room, I think we all have stories of people not knowing what the DOE Office of Science does. Around town, lots of stories about people not knowing what the Office of Science is, there are some in the scientific community who doesn't even know that the Department of Energy has an Office of Science. And we know there are many people who don't realize that the exciting experiment they read about, or the graduate student working down the hall, or the U.S. contributions to the ITER project being built in France are all supported by the DOE Office of Science. So please tell that story. We're all going to tell that story. Which brings me to another reason having to do with Washington. Policymakers in Washington make lots of decisions about supporting science. Every year, Congress and the President have to make decisions about how much funding all government research programs, and indeed how much most government programs receive. They have to make these decisions continually, year by year. And we know that the benefits and the impacts of non-science programs are often easier to describe to people. And stories of their impacts are easier to tell than for science programs, because the impacts are often immediate, concrete, and tied to people for non-science programs. The impact of Medicare, for example, is my mother going to the doctor last week. That's pretty immediate. For defense spending, it's my brother-in-law patrolling a Navy base. For transportation spending, it is the Southeast Freeway, a few blocks away, becoming a lot easier to navigate. So government investments in research aren't as real to most people. Sometimes they're not even real to me until I meet an NSF graduate research fellow, or I visit a national lab, or find out in talking to a scientist which federal agency, such as Office of Science, is supporting her work. That's when the colors on the slide, the dollar figures on my slides, become real to me. So if the federal government is going to keep investing in research, we all have to tell the stories about to decision makers about why it's important and what impact that investment is having in their communities, on people they know, and on the challenges that they care about. Because if we don't do it, then policymakers will only hear the other stories about other investments. Or they may think that investments in research are only these abstract dollars and colors that don't have an impact on their communities and their families. So I'm trying to do my part. As I told you, my part is making it clear that the research that federal policymakers decide to support is making a difference in giving us the knowledge and the technologies to make progress towards solving some of these challenges we care about. That's especially difficult when it comes to basic research, and I know that. That's probably the difficult part of the job. These are the stories that I try to tell. Together with the stories that you are going to tell, we're going to make sure that everyone knows, inside and outside Washington, that important, exciting science and engineering research is happening because of the DOE Office of Science. That the DOE Office of Science isn't just this building, but national labs and partners, dozens of university research and other partners. And that through the Office of Science, the U.S. government is supporting a lot more research and a lot more facilities than most people think. And that all is going to be very important for federal policymakers, our communities, and our nation to keep supporting the great work of the Office of Science. So I wish you luck in this important venture you're engaged in today. And please know that I am a part of your team, and I look forward to working together to make sure that these messages are communicated in the best way possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As an organizer, you sort of hold your breath, and then there's a great sigh of relief when your speakers knock it out of the park like they just do. I really, really appreciate that. He's graciously agreed to take a few questions.
Yeah. Yes.
Please identify yourself and your stanchions with microphones on them, if you use the microphones, because we are videotaping today.
Forgot about that.
Yeah. You said nothing. I wouldn't say to John. That's fine.
Oh, you have to turn it on. You have to flip the switch on the body of the thing. Yep. Should go up.
There it is.
Hi, okay, I'm Sonia Fernandez. I'm the science and engineering writer for UC Santa Barbara. Thanks for having me here. as a writer and as a former journalist, for many of us here probably, are very conscious of our audience, and usually in the university setting, our audience tends to be the people in the university. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about policymakers. So I guess in the context of this, summit, who, I guess we're sort of targeting policymakers or legislators or, you know, people who might make the decisions. Mm-hmm. What kind of you've already probably mentioned this, but what kind of questions would they want answered that we can sort of insert into the story that makes it more concrete to them? Because we, you know, we can talk to our grad students,
right,
and you know, people, like donors, alumni, that kind of thing, but you know, we don't normally talk to
them. I mean, it depends on the policy. So as I said, you know, for kind of for my, I'm actually not a policymaker. I think I advise a policymaker. But for Dr. Holder, when making decisions, it's often some of the questions I ask you. So, which federal agency is supporting this important work? And if it's successful, what kind of impact would it have on economic competitiveness, health, and clean energy, et cetera, some of these important national missions? I know that for, let's say, a congressional staff, in addition to those questions, it may be, what is it this research project doing in my state or my district? Are my constituents involved in it, or are they benefiting from it? So those are some of the questions that I think we usually ask. At least in my office, the first set of questions is what we ask. And occasionally we get asked those congressional questions to us, and then we have to find the answers and relay that to them about, you know, what impact this national research initiative is having on the science, but also on the community that they have to call. Okay.
So I'm Brian Cork with DOE in the Chicago office. Thank you for coming, by the way. Very, very interesting. Let me ask you to go a little deeper in some of the things that you said.
Okay.
So last meeting like this, the Secretary of Energy, Dr. Moody, said there is one audience, and that is Congress. And so, you know, sort of going down that path, whether one agrees with that or not, let me ask you two questions. The first one is, if, you know, I work in a facility in Illinois, and so in northern Illinois, all the members of Congress and the two senators, of course, from Illinois, know very well what's going on in those facilities. Mm-hmm. People from, you know, members from Indiana, southern Illinois, Missouri, etc., that aren't in our sort of wheelhouse, have a harder time relating to facilities, the activities that go on in our facilities, than those who are sort of geographically friendly to them. Do you have any insights in how to reach those people?
Well, I think the insight is in this room, in that, you know, although the labs are geographically specific, I mean, you have your university research partners who are all over the country. And I know that Office of Science supports a lot more than the research institutions that are in this room. I mean, they're, I think, over 100, right?
300.
Good. So here we have it.
Maybe
so,
more.
Maybe more. And
yes,
I just look at the top. I'm sorry. So I mean, that's the opportunity. And you know, with the facilities, like Argonne and Fermilab. It's not just the Fermilab and Argonne scientists using those facilities. It is university researchers from all over the country that are taking advantage of facilities, sometimes in person, but often these days, you know, virtually. And you know, that's where the impact of what the labs do spreads. It's through the university partners and the university users of those facilities. I won't disagree with Secretary Muniz that it's all about Congress, because Congress represents the people, right? And so, yes, we're the people. We are the people. We are the audience, and then they are one of the important parts of the audience that try to channel what we know and what we understand about, you know, scientific research. Thank you.
Second question, in the past, when we hear Congress, we think members. Can you talk to us about the power of speaking to briefing staffers?
That's very important. So this is my first time in the federal government. But so, you know, just like a congressional staff member works for a member of Congress, you know, I, as a like a professional staff member at OHTP, work for the president's science advisor. So I can say that, you know, staff, they, he and they rely on their staff to gather the information, to provide the options, and to, you know, gather and present the supporting evidence for any decisions that they make. So they and I guess we, are, you know, I think the right people to target, because members of Congress will don't have the time to dive into the impacts of every research project. Congressional staff have a little bit more time. They have a little bit more time and, you know, portfolio space to gather information, to do the research, to talk to constituents, to talk to scientists, etc. So I think they are important. And you should, when you think about Congress as an audience, you should think not only of the members of Congress, but also, and maybe primarily, the people who work for them, because they are the ones who distill information for the members.
Hi, I'm Terry Devitt. I'm at the University of Wisconsin. And my question to you is, as you're talking to us about the importance of communicating research, it's my day job, and I love writing about the science that you guys fund. What I'm wondering is,
in particular,
astrophysics to zoonotic disease.
Okay, well, okay. just wondering what side of the university's on. Yeah, okay.
The waterfront.
Okay.
And my question is, how are you communicating this message to the leaders of our institutions about the importance of sharing this kind of information with the rest of the world?
Well, I think many of the things that I'm saying to you, you know, Dr. Holder, my boss, says to the heads of institutions when they come and visit or when he sees them. For example, the president of Boston University, of another one of my alma maters, was in the office, and, you know, we impressed on the president the importance of communicating about all the research that Boston University faculty are doing, because we think it's important, and also because it's not a well-understood story. I mean, as an alum, I can say that a lot of people do not know yet that BU is now a major research university with a lot of important work going on. I want more people to know that, so it was an opportunity to have my boss tell the new president of Boston University how important it is. So pretty much in every conversation, I or Dr. Horton or my other colleagues give mini versions of the speech. It's important to keep communicating what you're doing, because not enough people understand it. And we find that from, you know, being around Washington, because, you know, we meet with members of Congress and their staff, and they, we have noticed, are not as aware as we think they should be about the exciting work that's going on in their universities or their national labs. They may only know part of the story. And for universities, they may know about the students who are going there, who are going to classes. They may not know that these students are involved in research. And often they certainly don't know that the Office of Science is supporting some of that research that the students are doing on their campuses. For the labs, they may know that it's there. They may know a lot about the operations and some of the projects that the lab is working on. But they may not know about the discoveries that are happening at that institution. They may not know about the students who are involved from their local communities in doing that research. So this is where I find it. So that's why we do try to communicate the importance of communicating on every chance that we get. Thank you for that question.
One last question.
One more, okay.
Yes.
Andy Fell, UC Davis. Thanks for inviting us here today. It's a very interesting day. This is really an observation that occurred to me as you were speaking about connecting people to the discoveries that are made in labs. And I think if you go to the street and you ask people who is creating technology that affects your life, they will say Apple or Google.
Yeah.
But those companies are building on what we've done in the past. So I think a lot of our challenge is how to connect that more basic research and technology transfer to industry as well and to, into products. Like, that's just a thought
that
for the room.
And it's a great observation. So we sometimes slip up, but for example, at the budget presentation that we were involved in yesterday, Dr. Cordova, National Science Foundation, they took great pains to point out that Google, for example, is based on an NSF-funded research project. That Qualcomm is based on NSF-funded research. And, you know, I reminded myself, you know, we need to do a little bit more of that to, you know, connect the basic research that we fund not only to these national challenges, but to brands, companies, that, and products that people know and use. So that's a good one.
Thank you very much. Well, while we prepare for our transition of slides and speakers, I will say something I should have said at the outset, which is that when we originally scheduled this program, it was scheduled for today because you guys could take advantage of coming to AAAS and capturing this session as well, but also because we give our speakers a week to recover from the budget rollout, which at the time was scheduled for a week ago. So you are seeing our speakers today, Dr. Murray, Dr. Koizumi, Dr. Orr today, all at their best, having had almost no sleep and for the last 48 hours, and the day was very, very long yesterday as they did their marathon briefings on this budget. So not to in any way to diminish expectations as we saw last night in New Hampshire, but just to give you a sense that these people have gone above and beyond the call of duty to drag themselves out again this morning to be able to be with you this morning and do that. With that, I'll reintroduce Dr. Murray and invite her to the podium. Thank you.
Yes, and on Friday, I am briefing the staffers of the appropriations committees on our budget rollout. I completely agree that staffers are incredibly important. So I'm going to tell you a bit about DOE Office of Science supporting universities. I have been aware of DOE Office of Science for a very long time. I'll tell you a bit of my background. I came from Bell Labs. I was supported by IBM, actually, in my graduate school research. I went immediately after I got my PhD in physics at MIT to Bell Labs. I was there for 27 years. So I definitely know the importance of science making transformative changes in technology, because that's what we did for 27 years. At the time, I then got on the board of Argonne National Lab. Then I got on the board of Brookhaven National Lab. I was on BSAC, Basic Energy Sciences Advisory Committee. I was in a number of reports coming out of BSAC. I was on the Rising of Gathering Storm Committee. When Bell Labs basically crashed and burned and was taken over by Alcatel, I became the deputy director of the chief research officer at Lawrence Livermore National Lab, getting more and more, and that's where I first met Jeff. And then I became the dean of engineering at Harvard, and now I'm here. I was sworn in December 21st, so this is my first budget rollout, and this is my first time as a federal official. It is incredibly important to communicate research, so I'm very glad to see all of you here. One of my priorities, you can read the slide, but one of my priorities is to increase the relationship building with research universities, with the Office of Science, because we actually do a great deal with universities, and universities are where young people are educated and do research. So you probably are quite aware of this, but the Office of Science, so I'm not going to tell you about FY17 budget proposal, but in FY16, we were $5 billion, roughly. 42% of that budget supports research directly. 40% of that research goes directly to universities. About 38% of the research goes to facility operations of the largest bunch of world-class user facilities of a single institution in the world. 30,000 scientific facility users at those facilities, and about 13.5% of that budget goes into constructing new facilities. We support over, I think it's really 24,000 scientists. As I said, 40% of them are at universities. We have our Office of Science programs. Basic Energy Sciences is the largest, of course. We do have science as a mission for the Department of Energy, but we have also nuclear security and safety, which is about 40% of the DOE budget. Science is about 20% of the DOE budget. Energy is about 20% of the DOE budget. And environmental cleanup is also about 20% of the DOE budget. We are the largest supporter of physical sciences research, high energy physics, and nuclear physics. We are the lion's share of the support, including at universities. For example, we support 90% of the nuclear physics research in the US, and something like 70% of the high energy physics research. We are the only supporter of fusion energy sciences, except for industry. And we do biological and environmental research, which is relevant for both understanding the effect of energy on climate and our environment, but also bioenergy and bioeconomy. And we are, along with DOD, leading the National Scientific Computing Initiative and going towards exascale computing. We support 17 national laboratories, all of them. We are the steward of 10 of them, and I assume the communications officers are all here today. Our investments in research facilities and construction look like this. And you can see a troubling trend of research going down and facility operations going up. It is our job to balance that so that the facilities that are absolutely essential for the research don't overtake the budget, and that's also one of my priorities. What that means, though, is that we are supporting world-class facilities, and that means we need to sunset some of them so that the new ones can be built and are world-class. Therefore, university and national lab priorities of the scientific communities are incredibly important, and the Office of Science, I have from outside witnessed how well the Office of Science does this. In the P5 particle physics report, the new nuclear science report. What I wanted to point out, though, is that 40% of the research goes to university, and 30% of the construction last year went to universities. We do competitive bids, and more the bids have been open to both labs and universities. So we do not have a quota for how much goes to labs versus universities. Universities have won 40% of the research, I'd say balancing between 35 and 40% over the last 10 years. And these are competitive bids. So I can't guarantee that it will be 40% next year, but I can pretty much assure you that it will be, because it's staying very constant. One of the things that I was very encouraged about is that the EFRCs, which are about $2 to $4 million a year for 5 years, going to 4 years now, so we can get on a every 2 year cycle, 80% of them were won by university leads. And this is very exciting. This is very basic science, but organized around the possibilities in transforming the energy system. All of them, like 99% of them, also are in collaboration with national labs. This, I think, is also very good. So just talking about your EFRCs in your institution would be a great thing, because they are use-inspired research, which is about a third of our research. That makes it easier to talk about, what effect could this new electrolyte for batteries have. Also, in the bioenergy research centers, which are at their ninth year, so in FY17 it will be their 10th year and final year, one of them was led by two universities, and you can see all of the universities that are connected to these bioenergy research centers, which have been highly successful. In the FY17 budget, we proposed to put $5 million. These are each funded at $25 million per year for, I said, the last 9 years, 10 years. We're going to put $5 million to each of them in FY17, should Congress agree to it, for translating those technologies to industry. So that's another good thing to talk about. Your university is public. Now, you cannot read this. I looked at this slide and said, don't we have a better slide about our user facilities? And the answer is not yet, but we will. Our user facilities are free of charge for competitive researchers. If you take, if you take the operating budget, if you look at the users in our user facilities, these here, you can't read that, but these are the light sources, synchrotron light sources, the neutron scattering facilities, I'm not sure we actually have our... We don't have our computation facilities up here. These are the Office of Science facilities that are not computing. If you add computing, you get to above 24,000 users. So that slide will be changed too. You can see that, for example, at the advanced photon source, we have over 5,000 users. Those users, I forgot to point out, are mostly students and postdocs. And over 50% of them, about 60% of them, come from universities. If you take, let's just say, 50% of the operating budget for the user facilities, for the light sources only, that means there's $240 million of support in effective grants to university users. This is not well known also. The facility operations supports of research in about 30,000 other, and this is where I think we have more than 300 institutions supported. So just a story of a graduate student that is working at a user facility would be great. And by the way, they get this competitively. They've won a competitive grant to use this time. We have a map on our website which shows where and in which congressional district the users come from. And they come from almost all districts. If you dig down deeper, you can see they come from all sorts of institutions, not just the major research university. And they win this competitively. We also have a grants map. So let me talk a little bit about university and lab collaborations, because they're pretty exciting. So at the LHC, there is a very interesting two-photon possible new physics that Princeton University spokesperson for international CMS recently announced, and this could be very cool. That spokesperson is a university person. In the Long Baseline Neutrino Facility and Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, otherwise known as LBNF, DUNE, in the FY17 budget, there is money to start excavating. There are over 150 institutions. Most of those are universities. And this is a true international project. Nuclear physics supports centers of excellence. You may not know that. I happen to know it because I am from MIT. And they have supported that center of excellence for 50 years, something like that. It's very long time support. And you can see across the United States the support for university work. The facility for rare isotope beams is on track, funded well in FY17, and is really going to be exciting. If you look at the kind of research they are going to do and what they contain in new heavy elements. Here is a good relationship between CHESS, the folks at an NSF-supported facility at Cornell, and SLAC, where they built detectors that have been used to determine the structures of whatever. some protein. This is extremely cool. UCLA, working with the nano foundry at Lawrence Berkeley lab, determining two precisions of a tenth of a atom, tungsten atoms. This is even more cool because you can understand the importance of this research, which is collaborative with a number of different universities. Oak Ridge, as you may know, has a mercury contamination problem, and understanding how you can methylate, you being a microbe, methylate mercury to produce the poisonous version of mercury is incredibly important, and that was done by university researchers in collaboration. So this is, call it environmental cleanup, but it's extremely important. It's actually very important for our fish consumption as well, because this gets into the rivers and oceans. I can talk about this here because this is led by Harvard University and one of the faculty in the School of Engineering, the Go Amazon campaign, which had a very large number of universities connected to it, and was measuring the emissions and cloud cover over the Amazon forest, pristine and near farming, near closures. And interestingly, they discovered that aerosol particles are mostly liquid, and that's unusual. And looking at what is covering, what kind of emissions are there, like 300 different chemicals emitted by trees. The climate modeling research, I'm very proud of this. Earth System Modeling ACME project, because I funded it at Lawrence Livermore National Lab with LBRD funding way back when I was there. But this is taking advantage of the massive computation that the DOE Office of Science has at the National Labs in parallelizing the climate codes. The current climate codes that NOAA uses are not parallelized. And this, in FY17, is going to become one of the codes that is user, it is first of all open source, and second will be an IPCC code. It is much higher resolution than the other codes. And we do, I have to say, actually, at Livermore, the Program for Climate Model Diagnostics and Intercomparison compares all of the current international climate models and has a very large database of these. And interestingly, I will say that if you average all the climate models, you get a better prediction than if you just look at one of them, because some of them have this chemistry, some of them have this better cloud model, so they're keeping track of, you know, how well are we able to actually model. And this is in collaboration with a very large number of university scientists. Fusion Energy Sciences, I will pick up my pace here, are doing, actually got on the cover of Physics Today. This is a very good collaboration between universities, industry, if you call General Atomics industry, and Princeton Plasma Lab. Of course, massively parallel computation and allowing university users to use the massively parallel computation in SciDAC awards is incredibly important, and you can actually now model both electron and ions in plasmas, which you couldn't do before at the same time, because they have a 2,000 times different mass ratio. And here's the University of Texas Austin simulation of high Reynolds number turbulent flow. And my last slide, which is looking at astrophysical explosions, also incredibly cool. Right up the line of DOE research and done by university researchers. and that's it.
Thank you very much. We have time for just a couple of questions, if you'd like to do that.
Good morning, Dr. Murray, and thank you for speaking to us today. I come from the Ames Laboratory, and speak in simple terms. I'm getting the impression that this morning from both of our speakers that we want to embrace the relationship that we have with our universities. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if you would just tell us, summarize in your own terms, what it is you want us to take away from the comments that you made today about embracing that relationship. There are many ways to go about that, but I'm not sure that I know exactly the appropriate way to go about that. So maybe you'll talk about that just a little bit more.
Sure. Well, there are a number of points also that Kei made, which is the education of young people and young scientists and engineers happens at our universities. And the leading edge thought in science and engineering happens in young people. And it's incredibly important, absolutely incredibly important, to connect those young people with national priorities in science and our national labs. So I think stories about students who get to work on these spectacular facilities is exactly the way to connect them. I will tell you from my own background, the reason I ended up at Bell Labs is because I did a summer employment at Bell Labs when I was in graduate school. And it was spectacular. And so the workforce development programs that we run at the Office of Science are spectacular. So it's not that the University of Iowa is running Ames. It's that the students at Ames get to interact with the people who are doing critical materials work for the nation. Does that answer your question?
So I'm Brian Quirk with DOE. Mm-hmm. That's somewhere along the way you might was as well. So I get to, first of all, I'm very offended that you said that young people are the key to everything. I'm very, very upset about that. Actually, I have a request for you. So, not only as the head of the Office of Science, it seems to me that you're not only sort of the chief scientist and the chief direction person, shall we say, but you're also a leader. And so, I would ask you, you've done a very nice job today, thank you, by the way, of emphasizing the importance of communication. But as I think several of my colleagues here have sort of mentioned, we need that message to go to our leadership as well.
Okay.
So if, kind of on one of those first slides, if one of those objectives that you have when you're speaking to audiences other than this or, to all of your audiences, if that could be one of the messages, that would go a long way to helping us, prioritize the some of the activities, yep. Some of the support activities that go on at the universities and research.
Yeah, so I will definitely do that.
Oh, thank you.
I spoke to the University Research Association on this very topic, and I'm going to talk, I think, next week to the Energy Sciences Coalition, which is a coalition of universities. Research officers and presidents, and as I am also going to visit universities, and of course national labs. I actually do think this message needs to go out, because first of all, it's the truth. Second of all, as I said, young people are incredible. It's really, really important. Our national labs, particularly the Office of Science Labs, are more and more open to the public and to young people and international scientists collaborating with them. They may have started out in the Manhattan Project completely closed. That is not the case anymore. And I think it is not well known. So I thank you for all of you for telling the stories, particularly of young people, I would say. and have a great summit.
Thank you.
So I invite you to join me in doffing your sport jackets or whatever top wear you can doff, because our DOE folks are now terrified it's going to be 0 degrees on Sunday, so they're hoping to keep the warmth going into them. I'm hopeful that we won't freeze tonight.
A little better.
There we go. So thank you very much for the warm welcome you gave to our principals this morning and talking. I reminded Kei again that message was right on target for us, and that we really appreciated him and Dr. Murray coming to join us when, ordinarily their schedule would have been way too busy to have been able to accommodate us on the day after the rollout. In fact, both of them were out hitting the streets and had to turn down other opportunities to do that in order to be here with us. So what I would like to do today is sort of sketch out the rest of the conversations. The initial conversations we're going to have today really revolve around this afternoon's breakout sessions, which is not to say that the panels we have in between and after are useless, but they are hoping to set up the conversations you want to have during the breakout sessions. So it's very important to me in all the summits that we've ever done that we have actionable outcomes and actually have things we can come to some consensus on, or at least help start the dialogue. This is a dialogue we want to have continue. This is a dialogue that's been going on for a while. Many of us have had these conversations around the value of university research, the value of communicating university research. I don't think we've ever really come at it from the perspective of how do we as feds work together with you as universities and explore that joint communication space and joint communication landscape. And I think that's a very productive one for us to have. And I think one of the places where we think that is particularly important for us to have is around the user facilities. And I think that's really what we'd like to sort of set up this first panel as. So we'll have a panel on user facilities, we'll have a panel on direct support of DOE, and then we'll break for lunch. And there'll be more logistics stuff from Natalie before we break for lunch. But the two panel sessions this morning are designed to set up those conversations in the breakout sessions. And when each breakout session is going to have a moderator and it's going to have a reporter. The reporter is just there to take notes today and isn't going to do anything, but your moderator is going to go back out at the end of the breakout sessions and you hear from her or him about the kinds of discussions and kind of issues. And I've given everyone, and I think they're all in your packets too, the provocative questions we think should come out of those discussions. And the panel discussions we're having this morning for at least two of those breakout sessions, if you're in social media, you're on your own. But if you're in the other two breakout sessions, these really are designed to sort of get you thinking about the kinds of questions that we're asking in this panel. And so the three questions, and I won't belabor them too much because you can read them in your packet, are things about the pipeline issue. How do funders know when the principal investigators publish research done at their user facilities? We have a devil of a time finding that out. So being able to help you, help us, help the PI get news out about her or his research is really critical to us, and that's one of the things we need to unpack in this conversation. How should the universities interact with the university facilities and in public affairs? And so the user facilities, depending on the lab, have different reporting relationships through their public affairs offices, and we'll have a little bit of that back and forth here about how that relationship works and who is your contact at whatever lab or whatever university or user facility you're looking at. And then lastly, who gets credit for work done at the user facilities? And I think that's the big elephant in the room for many of these conversations around credit. And it sounds appropriative, and it sounds picayune, and it sounds like this is what we're focused on, but by God, that's what we're focused on in many cases. So I think there's this pervasive feeling that credit shared is credit diluted, and we need to figure out a way of making sure that all of the partners in a research project or in a research finding can be equally acknowledged without diluting the credit. I think that with this with this team at the table, I think we can do that. Before I introduce the panel, I will say one more thing about this team we have here in the room today. I think I mentioned earlier on that we've had to expand the room twice because of really good response to the invitations we sent out. But we were very specific in who we invited here today. Don't tell people who aren't here. We were very specific in who we invited here today in order to get a good balance here in the room. We're about a third of the folks strictly from the national labs proper, about a third people representing user facilities, and which are or are not. Most of the time they're in national lab, but they aren't all. And we have a good example there. We'll be speaking in this panel. And then we also have about a third of the folks from universities, public information officers. And I think that the public information officers we chose are people that SOFAS worked with regularly or hears from regularly, or our top research performing universities under the DOE portfolio, the Office of Science portfolio. So that's why you see the people in the room you see. That's why I'm so delighted that so many of you are here. There are a few outliers we threw in for good measure, because a little spice is always good in something like this. And we have one person that I did want to call out to, and that's Matt Schau, who's sitting back here in the back. Stand up, Matt, so everyone can see you. Stick your head around the column there so everyone can see you. So Matt is new to the beat here. He's with the Headquarters Public Affairs Office here at the Department of Energy. He fancies himself our minder. We haven't disabused him of that yet. He's the person who is our liaison with public affairs and helps us sort of keep on track with departmental messages and broader meta messages. And it turns out that for a lot of reasons, basic research is just really hard to communicate in that broader context. And so during the day-to-day, if you have opportunities to say hi to Matt and sort of give him some guidance about what kind of things you think would be very useful to the department proper, talking about basic research, as opposed to all those whiz-bang technology things, that would be really great. Not that I meant to chime in. But that's really where we'd like to begin talking about some of the issues and the difficult challenge of basic research communication, not just at the universities, but everywhere. That's the first order problem. You have packets of bios for everybody in a page of bios of everybody. So we're going to not do a whole lengthy introductions of folks here. I'm going to introduce for these panels, we're going to introduce the moderator and allow the panelists to introduce themselves briefly as part of their opening presentation. But for user facilities, if you came to the Department's Office of Science, you would almost certainly come to Ben Brown, who is our moderator today. Ben is the person who works in the Office of Science SC2, which is our science place, where all of our planning and policy and dollars about the office come to rest. And between him and the moderator of our next session, Patrick Glenn, they have been a really strong piece of our communications process here, and I think they'll both talk a little bit about how they interact with that process. Ben's been very helpful to us. One of the things you'll see in the packet also is the requirements for acknowledgement of federal support, and that's something that Ben will be particularly able to talk about because he was the principal architect of that with Patrick and me and some other folks and the associate directors who engaged in this. And it's particularly interesting to see how we are trying very hard to get the user facility name out there and branded specifically. I'll stop there, let Ben take over, and thank you all panelists.
Thanks, Ray. Can you all hear me okay? Mm-hmm. Well, a really kind introduction, and it's a pleasure to be here, and I'm looking forward to meeting a lot of new faces. You see some familiar faces. And I was told before this session that I should not use PowerPoint, and I swear I completely forgot.
Ben.
Is that better? So I only have a couple slides, and then we'll get to these.
I told him. I warned
him. He really did, and I apologize profusely. So I am the author of that horrid slide that Dr. Murray mentioned, so my career is over. But I have this slide, which is just to say that, that are a huge part of what we do. We're kind of equal parts direct support for researchers through grant making and support for these facilities that are used by thousands of individuals. It defies one slide. I mean, this is not a great slide, but there's 28 of these, right? So that's part of the challenge I see. How do we articulate a really heterogeneous portfolio of amazing, from supercomputers to light sources, particle smashers, fusion machines, atmospheric monitoring capabilities. But just to echo again, Dr. Murray, these things have some pretty unique attributes that we can't ignore. They're open. So you come with an idea, and you can compete for access. They're free if you intend to publish in the open and return to non-proprietary report. And this was not always the case. I mean, this is a model that didn't just kind of pop up from nowhere. It took decades to kind of come to this place. And they're unique. And I want to emphasize that it's the people at these places that make them unique. And actually, my number's wrong. It is 24,000 research papers. We have many, many thousands of people that support these domains. So I just want to spend a very brief couple minutes on a kind of cartoon expression of the differences in the relationship that we see from headquarters and how we see the world. But also, for, you know, if you're a researcher, what is your experience with the Office of Science? You might be a grantee, so there's the Office of Science, and there's a nice pile of cash. And you have an idea, you maybe like some cash to pursue your ideas. So if you're lucky enough to win a grant, then you get the cash, and maybe you reward yourself with a raspberry blue Slurpee. And it turns your lips blue, and you're very happy. But if you're a facility user, you're not chasing cash, you're chasing an idea that needs to be hammered on with a supercomputer or a high-intensity x-ray source that nobody can provide to you because they're too expensive or too unique. So it's a totally different value proposition that these people approach this DOE resource. They're not chasing dollars, they're chasing work that needs to get done and a tool that they want to apply to get that work done. So of course, we're Office of Science, yo, hey, we're over here, we have the money that the Congress provided us to make that happen, but the field users don't care about that, honestly. And in fact, they don't even care maybe that the X-ray light source has an argon or Berkeley, they just want the X-rays. They just want to show up and do the work. So what's the other part of this puzzle is that, you know, these are human beings, right? So that, you know, who are they interfacing with? If you're a grantee, you're interfacing with the program manager, and this is a scientist. But from your perspective as communications professionals, this is not exactly that. I hate when I say, and I'm friends with many program managers, and I respect them, and these are people who toil in anonymity and do amazing things. But the grantee tends to think of them as a bureaucrat hogging machine sometimes. That's horribly pejorative. But this is not, you know, this is not a communications story. But this one is. This is my little, you know, soapbox. The facility staff scientists at these user facilities are incredible researchers in their own right. And they are seeing a whole host of different users that they're connecting with. And so user facilities are hubs in a really meaningful way, and this is something that a story that is not told. We focus a lot about the end product, you know, the research that comes out of the facility, the research that comes out of a grant. But there's this kind of meta story of how, okay, I'm a huge Star Wars fan. Sorry. User facilities are kind of like the most icy spaceports of science. I mean, people are coming in and out all the time. It's an incredibly vigorous and exciting place. And so a few of the themes I hope we can connect on during this short panel and later in the breakout is that, you know, facilities enable discovery, of course, but they're also, there's a story of service here. This facility staff scientist is giving up the majority of their time to help other scientists connect with a tool. But oh, by the way, they're actually a human collaboration machine, making connections between users, saying, hey, you should talk to this person over here, an industry user talking to a university person. Oh, and by the way, we've heard about youth this morning. Yeah, a lot of grad students and postdocs get sent to up across the country and do the experiment. But they're exposed to a whole other different raft of characters. You know, it's a really vigorous space. The pace is extreme because you've got this much time to get this much done. So there's just a lot going on. And then you already heard about that's my little PowerPoint.
I can. Shall I do it up there?
It's up to you.
Can I use your slides?
You can do it.
No.
Okay.
That's fine. You can.
Did you have a slide?
I have one slide at the end that hopefully is connected to the internet, so
okay,
we can show something, but we don't have to look at it now.
Okay.
Thanks, Rick, for having me here today and for giving me the opportunity to share the uniqueness that is the Joint Genome Institute. Like our brethren at the other national user facilities, the synchrotrons, the supercomputing centers. We are data generators for a very specific user community. Unlike our brethren, we are the only national user facility in the world devoted to the technology of DNA sequencing and other omics to characterize the biosphere. So how did DOE get involved in this enterprise, you may ask? A little bit of history is required here. And in fact, it was...
How did DOE get involved in this?
Thanks, John. I'm glad you asked that. It was 30 years ago, 1986, that the Department of Energy was the first federal agency to put up $5 million in seed funding to see whether in our lifetime we could sequence the human genome. That sounds like a very preposterous statement now, but to put it in perspective, my boss, the director of JGI, Eddie Rubin, received his PhD for sequencing six nucleotides, or six letters of the genomic alphabet. We've come a long way since there and then. So emboldened by the resources within the National Lab System and the expertise, DOE got together with NIH and in 1990 launched what was supposed to be a $3 billion, 15-year enterprise to characterize the human genetic code. Things got going rather slowly at first until the resources within the National Lab System were consolidated into a virtual institute in 1997, and then in bricks and mortar in Walnut Creek, California, the Joint Genome Institute, roughly equidistant between Lawrence Livermore and Lawrence Berkeley, where we draw our workforce. We tackled three human chromosomes, 5, 16, and 19, that speak to the interest, the abiding interest of the Department of Energy in human genomics, and that was the health effects related to energy use and generation. So JGI was the first to complete its obligation to the Human Genome Project, published their findings, the analysis of those chromosomes, about 12% of the human genome in the journal Nature, and then stepped back and said, now what? National Institutes of Health support five sequencing centers around the country, all devoted to humans, how selfish, and human disease. Nobody was looking at the rest of the biosphere as it relates to the DOE mission in bioenergy, which is to say cellulosic biomass being broken down by enzymes sourced from fungi and microbes in nature to create next generation biofuels, and looking at the vast microbial dark matter of the planet to see how it informs all those biogeochemical processes that that invisible world control. So, what have we done for you in the last 12 years or so? Fast forward to the time now, where last year we sequenced 143 trillion letters of plants, fungi, and microbes, and collections of microbes we know as metagenomes. To put that into context, that's the equivalent of a city of about 48,000 people, like Charlottesville, Virginia, with classes in session, at a cost of a fine dinner in San Francisco and a decent bottle of wine, and it takes about the time in which you can down a cup of coffee to sequence those 3 billion letters of the equivalent of the human genome. When Kei was talking earlier about the exciting science stuff that we generate, I think in terms of the personalities driving the science of our 958 members of our user community. Jill Banfield, for one, from UC Berkeley, who donned a moon suit and crawled into the depths of a Superfund site in Northern California that was spewing sulfuric acid into the upper reaches of the Sacramento River, scraping a pink biofilm off a rock and sending it FedEx to us, so that we could put Humpty Dumpty back together again and identify the bad actors in that environment that were responsible for contaminating the river. Or I think of Jerry Tuscan from Oak Ridge National Laboratory and the Bioenergy Science Center at Oak Ridge. The BRC's Bioenergy Research Centers represent a third of our capacity. Jerry is really Mr. Poplar, and Poplar has been popular to the Department of Energy since the 70s. Grows very fast. If you want to grow trees for fuel, Poplar was chosen as that. It's a very sophisticated genome, about a third of the size of the human genome, with twice as many genes. He's discovering all sorts of things related to disease resistance and growth habit of these trees. When I think of, and was introduced to Sonia from Santa Barbara, I think of a young investigator there named Michelle O'Malley, who's working on us in a joint program with the Environmental Molecular Sciences Laboratory at PNNL on the subject of zoo poop. I've said it, zoo poop. So there's exotic animals that are exquisitely capable of breaking down biomass into something that we could use as a drop-in fuel. We're working with Michelle on that. So where do we go from here? It's not that we characterize everything under the sun. We cleave very closely, thanks to Patrick and Dan Drell, to the DOE mission, and which is to say that when we look at, say, the interface between roots and the soil microbes, in that handful of soil, there are as many bacterial cells as there are stars in the Milky Way, to give you a sense of how boggling reconstructing that environment and then making this information freely available to our worldwide user community. But the most abiding question that we get as a national user facility is, what the heck is a national user facility? So in the last 2 weeks, I was thinking about leading up to this event, and that is, how can we embed in our news releases to solve that one question in short form? And if you don't mind indulging me for a moment, yesterday I was at the Renwick, and I recommend it to you, and I saw this Einstein quote there, and to me what it summarizes is wonderment. But as Kei said, it's not just wonderment, but also we need to convey the relevance and context for the taxpayers and to generate a sense that they're getting their money's worth. So I know it's a high-risk endeavor I'm embarking on here, but having finished this at about 1 this morning, you guys are going to be the guinea pig, and I trust that you'll provide some useful feedback. And take it away, Natalie. Just crank that puppy up.
Complex information embedded in our planet's DNA. There are trillions upon trillions of organisms in our biosphere, each with their own genome, and each has its own story. JGI deciphers this massive amount of information to discover the roles these organisms can play in generating new sources of energy and informing new scientific discoveries that will improve our environmental stewardship. In order to transmit this deep pool of data to the scientific community, JGI works hand-in-hand with the National Energy Research Scientific Computing Center, or NERSC, and the Energy Sciences Network, or ESNet. These three unique resources reside at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and are known as National User Facilities, supported by the Department of Energy Office of Science. Just as water flows throughout the world to sustain human survival, high-quality genomic data generated by JGI flows to the scientific community to sustain scientific discovery and innovation. In its role as a national user facility, JGI invites researchers from around the world to supply JGI with thousands of DNA samples collected from nature. Like turbines, the highly specialized instrumentation and intellectual expertise of JGI churn out a massive data resource by decoding and assembling genomes, the DNA sequences comprised of the chemical letters A's, T's, C's, and G's, of the organisms sourced from the samples, providing an intricate biological snapshot of a particular ecosystem. This information is then converted to the digital language of zeros and ones. These data, constituting a deep reservoir of thousands of different plant and microbial genomes, are stored and managed at NERSC. Like a generator that converts water's potential energy into electrical power, ESNet serves as the conduit that speeds the flow of JGI's information at a rate that's 15,000 times faster than an average home network. Together, NERSC and ESNet store, manage, and create a high-speed information flow akin to our nation's energy grid, the infrastructure that powers our economy. Delivering these data full circle back to the community of thousands of scientists who perform research across a wide spectrum of applications to answer urgent energy and environmental questions. In turn, our scientific collaborators or users share their findings through scientific and popular literature. Ultimately, the goal is to generate these data to improve our understanding of the world, make predictions, and foster discoveries, like how to develop the next generation of sustainable biofuels, or how complex environmental systems will respond as the climate changes. These inseparable components, JGI, NERSC, and ESNet, are among dozens of different national user facilities working together to advance the frontiers of science in support of the nation's economy and the environmental integrity of the planet.